Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to our program, Voices from Our Community. I'm your host, Ed Terrell. This evening, we have a very interesting program for the community. It's based on education and jobs. Normally, we have a three-topic program for you, but this evening, we're just going to deal with education and jobs. We like to have some home viewers, but we like to have the home viewers call in that are relevant to the subject matter that we're discussing. If not, please do not call in and disturb us with bigotry and negative comments, because we're here to have a diverse conversation with our audience, which is the home viewers and the people out in Reading, to inform them of various information that you normally wouldn't hear in the mainstream media or in the community itself. So tonight we're going to be focusing on education, and my guest here is a part of our panel. We have Mr. Nate Washington.
Hello.
And we have Mr. Ed Morrison. And our subjects tonight is education and jobs, like I said, and we're going to start out with education. And now that school has started, it's September and the school season has started, and there's various schools. There's the public school system, there's private schools, and there's charter schools, there's home schools. But in the basis of all this schooling, what is the grassroots of education? And I'd like to start out with Mr. Morrison to try to give you that information of what is education, Ed?
Thank you. The last show, I have a correction I'd like to make, Ed.
Yes.
In our last show, we identified the new principal of Reading Senior High School as Eric Thurman, and the correct pronunciation of his name is Eric Terman. So, Mr. Terman, I apologize for putting the TH sound in your name. Nonetheless, I want to wish you success in your new position as principal at Reading Senior High School. And for that, I'd like to move forward. In regarding your question about education, Ed, I've been writing a thesis on education in America as it relates to African Americans. And the history of education in America in general has always been sort of perplexing, because education has always been for the affluent as opposed to the underclass. And when we realize that the public school systems come into play, what does education do for those who are not part of the wealthy class? We realize that education is an institution that's designed to facilitate the industrial complex. America has developed into an industrial complex that has gone global. And the workforce in America is no longer needed when they've tapped into a cheaper workforce by way of China and India. So what to do with the unemployed workers in America, and what to do with the educational process that fed into the employment of students who graduate from high school as well as students who graduate from college. Because we moved into a technical revolution, high school diplomas are no longer adequate for employment. We have to go beyond high school. So the technical training and the higher education has to be readdressed and reformatted. And that process is an ongoing process. So as it relates to the implementation of charter schools, I'm still trying to figure out what the alternative education is about as related to the traditional education. So when you talk about the charter schools, we have one here in Reading. It's established. I wish ILEAD success in their endeavor. I see that Reading is making an attempt to address its issues, but the broader concern is what is America going to do with all the children that do graduate? Where are we going to put them? we claim, the president's claiming he has a job programs, but from where I'm sitting, I don't see any changes occurring unless he waves a magic wand. You still have discrimination within the educational system. You still have discrimination within the employment system. So until you eradicate those types of discriminations, you're not going to really see any changes. So we know that education has always served the affluent, or it serves industry.
And the root source of education, where was it really implicated in our society, in this particular society? Where did it start, the informational form of educating people to assimilate into either the industrial attributes of this society or the agricultural attributes? Where was some of the first classrooms, should I say?
Well, you have to look at the schools that were started by the churches or the religious organizations. They've been instituted since the Quakers came to America. If you're talking about public schools, then you have to go back to 1852 in Massachusetts, where the first public school was established, and then you have to go a year later to New York, and you'll find that those two states represented the North in terms of its industrial. When you talk about education in the South, for a while, African Americans didn't receive education because they had laws that prohibited the education of slaves. And even when that situation was changed, the education in the southern states was still difficult for African Americans to acquire. So when you look at the initiative of establishing public education, it was to feed the industrial North. The reason why the North won the Civil War was that they had a larger industrial base than the agriculture or the agrarian South. So, you know, when you look at the difference between the agrarian economies and the industrial economies, the machines are going to win because they can manufacture the materials that will aid and abet war. So when you look at the schools established in the North, they were established to feed into industry. When you ask a child, what are you going to be when you grow up? You can be a fireman, a policeman, a teacher, and those are good, healthy jobs. But they all are predicated on a sound economy, a tax-based economy. If you do not have other people employed in other jobs, the taxes will not come in to support police, firemen, or teachers, because most of them are municipal jobs.
Service jobs.
Okay, so when you look at how and why public schools were started in this country, then you see that all that's changed. Industry has left. So basically, there's no need as such to educate the en masse population, you know, the whole population, because it's you're not going to give them the employment. You're not going to be able to employ them because we lost our manufacturing capabilities. Mm-hmm. As much as 85 to 90% of our manufacturing capabilities have left and went to other countries. Everything we got is made in China.
So we have an educational system that just started up this September, this school year for the year 2011 and 2012. And there will be a graduating class of 2012. So the opportunity for a lot of those graduates, they will either have to go into the academical type of clerical work or computer technological work. There is no factories for the hands-on type of student to go into. So all this 12 years of education is, can you say, what is it for? If there's no jobs to sustain the 12 years of education.
I have my opinion is that it's a habit. We're so used to functioning out of a habit. We have a routine, mm-hmm. and this routine is going along, but we don't have anything to sustain this routine. You have 26 million people in this country that are unemployed. They just put out some figures today, the 13th of September, that 44% of the population is in poverty. 16% of the children in this country are in poverty. We've had poverty in this country for 45 years, 50 years, we've acknowledged it. And we have done very little to change it because there's a system in place that says we're going to teach the teachers to continue the routine. Teaching the teachers has been ineffective because when you go to deal with poverty, the only thing that benefits out of poverty are the people who are getting paid to deal with poverty. And the people that poverty is supposed to be dealt with, they're not getting anything other than the shuffle.
So there are the statistics of the program. So I kind of saw that. This is why I'm keep on talking about this year particularly. I noticed how people were very enthusiastic about going back to school this year. And I saw it as just like you just mentioned, I saw it as like a routine because they aren't looking at the big picture of this particular type of education, the routine that it leads to. The parents, they have good intention, but are they getting the bottom line of their intentions by preparing their children for school when the school itself is based on an industry that's capitalizing on their particular child going there without results? Can you understand that part of what I'm seeing and what I'm feeling, that there is no absolute that a child will graduate and have a successful job based on the facts of the statistics that you just mentioned and what we are going through as a country financially and socially, that the jobs are not here for a high school diploma graduate?
I would argue that the jobs are here, but they're not here for students who have went through the public educational program. The jobs are going to the students who attend private schools. Mm-hmm. And the statistics are not available yet as to the percentage of homeschool, charter school, and alternative education programs as related to private academies, private schools. The private student in ninth grade is compared to a student in public schools senior year.
Easily.
So it's conceivable that a student that attends a private school will be reading at a 12th grade level. And students who are in public schools, for the most part, are reading below grade level. So if you look at it that way, you say, well, there's a greater amount of students who attend public school than who attend private school. That's the way it's always been. And there's where, if you looked at corporate America today, the elite echelon or the top echelon, the higher level, the upper level of management all went to private schools. Albright College is a private school, Harvard is a private school, and when you look at the CEOs of America, the individuals that run corporate America and the individuals that are on their staff and their immediate vice presidents and what have you, they've all attended private schools. I would give the variable of 5% went to schools that were not private. And that's the cream of the crop coming out of those schools that are not private. So in essence, the public school system is basically a prospecting scam. They're looking for the greater minds who can function at a higher rate of speed. And if they are able to maintain the pace with the teacher, they're going to be rewarded. If they can't maintain pace with the model that is being implemented, then they fall behind and they do not benefit from the society that perpetuates and rewards good behavior and those who follow instructions.
So it seems like an absolute disaster, especially if there's that 5% can go on and achieve, and the other 90% don't have manufacturing or industrial types of jobs to fall into. That particular source has changed. The manufacturing labor, the physical labor that used to not require a high school diploma. You could go into any factory and sit down at a machine and kind of be subservient to that machine and come home with a paycheck every week or every other week and maintain your family on that. But we have lost that type of job base here in America. So the hopelessness that I'm talking about in a public school education is very relevant to actually keep perpetuating to a situation where there's no jobs. And I see it as I'm in this community that there's no jobs. Yes, Nate? Mm-hmm.
If I may interject, both of you gentlemen are correct. Still, I have to be the voice coming from the woods and encourage the seemingly hopeless 95% to continue to educate themselves by reading, as us three gentlemen do, continue to take up hobbies, continue to learn about automotives as much as they can, go to your libraries and see if they have any forms of training in any endeavor, because at the same time, even though it's almost hopeless, you cannot surrender to surrender. You have to continue to educate yourself, and maybe one day the economy and everything else will change and your mind will continue to be sharpened, and you might have an opportunity to do something then. But never give up educating yourself, sharpening your mind and your skills.
You're absolutely right, Nate. I wasn't trying to paint a picture that there was total doom and gloom and hopelessness. I was just trying to make the home viewers aware that we have an educational system here that is absolutely failing. It's failing for the fact that there is no light at the end of the tunnel unless you as a student apply for that, look for that other way out. This evening we have brought to here to this program a list of African American inventors of some of the things that we take for granted every day in our society that has been manufactured and produced through the black minds of our ancestors. I'm going to start out with reading some of those, and Nate is going to read some of them, and then I would have Ed read you some. It's a list. It goes on. It seems like we have here over maybe 200 or 300 items that were invented by black Americans. For number one, the first four are coming directly out of Africa. And number one is paper, chess, the alphabet, medicine, and the top of the list, civilization. We have the biscuit cutter, folding beds, coin machines, car coupons, letterbox such as mailbox, the ironing board. Could you read some, Nate?
Sure. I have a stainless steel pad. Mm-hmm. We have a guided missile. We have a torpedo discharger, street sweeper, disposable syringes, the horse bridle bit, home security system. Shall I continue?
Yes, a little more, okay. Please.
We have the horseshoe that was invented by the African American. Naturally, you have your peanut butter, paints and stains, and lotions and soaps that were invented by the same gentleman who invented the peanut butter. We have the arm for the record player. Back in the day, those of us who had those old record players on the 33s will know what we're talking about. We have the toilet. There's one. We have a guitar. We have a golf tee. We have ice cream. We have the gas burner. We have that super soaker. Remember that huge
water gun? Yes.
And the gentleman, I have a little info on the gentleman. He actually is a rocket scientist that mm-hmm. works for NASA, who invented that super soaker, Mr. Johnson. We have the eye protector. We have the air conditioning unit. We have printing press. Okay, that's it for me.
And Ed Morrison, would you like to read some, if we can just contribute some of the inventions of African-American women? It's on the second page mm-hmm, mm-hmm. of the paper that you have. Some of the inventions that we use in our society today that was contributed to the African-American inventors.
Yeah, from the top you have a fireplace damper, a lens holder, ironing board, bed rack. Didn't you say torpedo discharger before?
Mm-hmm,
and
mm-hmm.
that was invented by a woman named mm-hmm. Henrietta Bradbury?
Yes.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Wall hanging kits, clothes wringer, portable receptacle, napkin pocket, carrier attachment for invalid walker, mm-hmm. bathroom tissue holder, backwasher mounted on shower wall and bathtub, weaving straw with silk, pastry fork, hairbrush. You know, as I look at this list and know that these inventions came about because of necessity, and that created industry, cottage industries. It also created a manufacturing arm
base
within this country.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
My question would be, what will we as a country with its diverse population have to create in the 21st century to meet the technological needs of a global economy?
Very good question.
Have we exhausted everything that could be invented in terms of the oil base, an oil-driven economy? Can we set that aside and say, this is what we need to do? For the longest time, we've known that the skilled trades have been segregated. And my question is, what will be the new trades of the future? Because the plumbers are not dealing with copper tubing as much as they used to when they're dealing with plastic.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
The carpenters in the future may not have the wood to work with because of the ecology of the forestry. And unless we produce trees fast enough, the carpenters in the future will be very limited and wood would be very expensive. So when I look at these lists and see the fruit press, the illusion, the float-operated circuit closer, tissue tote, you know, all of these inventions were from a bygone era. This is our history. But now we have to make our future. And if we are not educating the children in the sciences, if you, as a student, if you don't look for chemistry, biology, or physics, you will not have a place inside of professional America.
Yes, you're right, Ed. And one of the basic foundations for any type of person being a scholar and an inventor is to have the basic scientific background and understanding of the past. A lot of the inventions that we just mentioned here and read off here, I do not believe our children are learning about their ancestors' feats and achievements mm-hmm. in the academic field. You could even just kind of speculate and say maybe 65% or 85% of our children are not being aware of where we have come from as a people mm-hmm. to kind of assimilate into this society and kind of go towards that futuristic goal of where we are going. Now, Mr. Nate Washington has...
Do you remember this? You gave it to me. Let me just give you the...
synopsis.
Let me give you
one
this.
One moment. We're gonna have a little break here, and we're going to come back after the break, and we're going to go into some subject matter that's very, very relevant to our community.
Mm-hmm.
You're watching Voices from Our Community on bctv.org. Be informed. Be involved. Be a member. For membership information, go to bctv.org/support/membership. For more local information, go to bctv.org.
Well, welcome back. That was a quick break, but now we're back with more information. Mr. Nate Washington is here this evening with us, as you all know, and he has some Pacific inventors that he would like to read off, about four of them, who have invented things that are very, very relevant to our society in general. Nate?
Thank you very much, Ed. Our first person that we'll introduce to you tonight, inventor, Mr. Granville T. Woods. During the 20th century, you had four great inventors that ran the industrialized world. One was Mr. Thomas Edison, another one was Westinghouse, another one was Ford, and the one that they never allow us to see is Mr. Granville T. Woods, who had 60 patents to his credit. Most of his work was done with the railroad system, a system that we know here as Reddingites, was the richest company in the world, the Reading Philadelphia Railroad System. This gentleman has 60 patents that improved that railroad system. Also, he has the notoriety of having beaten Mr. Thomas Edison in court twice for trying to pirate two of his inventions, and that in itself is an honor whenever Mr. Edison would try to relieve you of an invention. This showed this man's brand. Granville T. Woods, if you would, out there in the viewing audience, if you don't mind, get a paper and pencil so you can look these up and validate them for yourself. Next, we have Lewis Howard Latimer. Now, this young man, his birthday was September 4th. That's the anniversary of his birthday. Very interesting young man. He educated himself, as I was encouraging everyone out in the viewing audience to continue to do. Learn everything. Everything you can about everything. Never surrender educating yourself. This gentleman here is responsible for helping us maintain light bulbs as we know them. Mr. Edison, he worked in Mr. Edison's laboratory for a minute. Mr. Edison came up with this light bulb, which was a great invention, but it would not last for more than a couple of hours. So he got this young studious man and asked him, he said, "Louis, see what you can do with it." Well, as history would have it, Lewis came up with some filaments that we now enjoy in our light bulbs. Also, after he did this, there was a gentleman named Alexander Graham Bell who had invented this beautiful machine called a telephone. He didn't know what it was supposed to look like, and since this same Lewis Latimer was a draftsman, among other things, he asked his friend Thomas Edison, he said, "Could you send that young man over and see what he can do about this telephone thing?" Mr. Lewis Latimer drew the telephone, never having seen it. So this is what makes him one of the great American inventors. He helped improve Edison's light bulb by making it last for the months and the years that we now enjoy, and he drew up the telephone. Next on our list, we have a Garrett Morgan. Now, most of us know about Mr. Morgan. He's the gentleman that's responsible for our traffic lights. Mr. Ford invented the automobile, the iron horse, and so forth and so on. And that was all well and good, except that if you do not teach people control or make them behave, they were taking these automobiles and turning them into weapons, actually. Mr. Morgan created the order that was needed. Also, right here in Pennsylvania, there was a coal miner disaster over in western Pennsylvania, if I'm not mistaken. And Mr. Morgan had created the gas mask or gas hood that saved the lives of multiple coal miners who were trapped. He has also many other patents. If I'm not mistaken, he also is responsible for a water closet on our trains, toilet, if you will. Next, we have Patricia E. Bath. And since we're on the topic of education, excuse me, we can all learn a great hand from this lady. This lady has so many degrees until it's almost equal to the same number of a deck of cards. She believes in education, constant education. She is the one responsible for the latest removal of cataracts. My mother had the privilege and the pleasure of being one of her first patients under this process of laser phaco probe, which became very painless after a while. Her process was a very painless extraction of the removal of cataracts. Whereas in the years previously, prior to that, we literally grinded out the cataracts. Very painful process. Dr. Patricia Bath, she made it a lot more pleasurable and a lot more efficient. Last but definitely not least, we have Mr. Frederick McKinley Jones. Now, when we're out there in the sweltering heat anywhere, be it on the plane or in the street or bus or what have you, we can really thank this gentleman because he came up with refrigeration. In the old days when we had the trucks, we used to have to move meat products to and fro across the country. And what we found out, most of the meat would be spoiled by the time it arrived. Well, Mr. Jones sat here. They called him the man of 1,000 ideas. He sat down and he created refrigeration that led to our air conditioning and so forth and so on. Very comfortable gentleman. Thank you very much.
So it's basically what you're saying is we did it, they hit it.
They did it, that's right. We did it, they hit
it. So in
order
to...
Under your nose all the time, excuse me.
In order to raise the consciousness of our children, we must understand and apply arche, which means that in order to move forward, we must have to take a step back. In other words, before we can be prepared for the future, we must comprehend the past. And some of the things that are very important in education is to be inspired. And by understanding some of the contributions of our ancestors and some of the contribution of people who came before us, it has to be taught in the schools. When you send your children to school and they're given a one-sided form of education that doesn't really reflect who they are as a person, of where they came from, who they are, where they came from, and where they're going, it's easy to have this kind of dismay about the future and how to prepare for the future when the subject matters that you're studying in schools is not really based on absolutes. They're based on intellectual conjures of perceptions. And that being said, Ed, in the middle of your thesis that you're kind of writing concerning education, you were explaining to me how it's formulated and to the point that they want to assimilate people to maintain a system. And this system is failing because the input of the majority is not really being heard or comprehend.
Well, what you read earlier, it brought to mind the models of instructions that have been created through mathematical formulas by the so-called educational psychologists. B.F. Skinner, Edward Lee Thorndike. And these individuals, along with what they did was they took Pavlov's theory of conditioned reflexes and molded into conditioned response and developed an educational process that would actually tell people what to think and how to act. Now, when you look at today, and I juxtaposed the public schools and the private schools teach a different instructional model than what they teach in public school. The public model in a rural school would be different than an instructional model from an urban school. In the rural school model, they may direct the students towards a vocation. The rural student, along with the urban student, may have the same economic or similar economic hardships. But the educational model that's occurring in urban schools are geared to frustrate and to confuse students and cause them to react in a certain way. Again, if the student has the ability to maintain pace with the teacher, they will be successful in any particular model. But in the private models, private school models, they're more designed to teach as opposed to instruct. And the difference is ever so slight, but ever so slight means a whole lot. You miss by one degree and you could be 200 miles away. It's just the models that have been developed by the so-called educational psychologists that have everything all screwed up. Ronald Reagan, President Ronald Reagan in the early 80s, he criticized public schools and said that they created their problem. And when you look at what took place in the middle 60s and all of the federal monies that have been earmarked to deal with issues within public schools, and who profited the most from those monies, all they did was sustain employment for themselves, and it's perfect example of what's being done today within the Reading School District.
So, like in the private schools, you can send a child to a private school and his teachers and his peers, they would basically be reflecting his environment, his social beliefs and understanding compared to an inner city child going to a public school where he's dealing with professors and teachers who are not from his community, has no understanding of his ethnicity, his values, or his culture, and that is designed to teach or basically instruct him on how to assimilate into a class that has nothing to do with his past or where he's coming from. So it's hard. You get children who have so-called behavior problems where they want to give them medication.
Yeah.
And are you familiar with that?
Yes. There's a Dr. Helmut. Let me pronounce his name correctly because he needs to be held accountable. Dr. Helmut Reschmidt, who believed that Ritalin would control a disruptive student's behavior. Today they realize that if a student is disruptive, it's probably because his needs are not being met. So how do you meet those needs? The self-efficacy of Albert Bandura, who a professor out of Stanford University is talking about how students are rewarded and the confidence that they acquire from individuals who encourage positive thinking, giving them positive feedback and rewarding their efforts. When you look at the different educational models, I would venture to say that within one school district, urban school district, you will have some schools that are teaching although they may have the same grades, you have some schools that are teaching a better model or reading from better books. Mm-hmm. You have one school, say, in the northeast section of a city that is reading from a better book or a more informative book, and in one section you may not have enough books to go around, depending on the economic strata or the economic level of income for that particular area.
For that district, yeah.
For not only within the district, but within that certain areas of the district. You have individuals whose homes and their property taxes account for the tax structure. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, you have groups of individuals who are living in federally subsidized homes. It's a federally subsidized community. Mm-hmm. And therefore, they have no input. Thomas H. Ford. And it took them 20-some years for them to fix the air conditioning and get the asbestos out. And then I heard the air conditioning broke again. And it's a continuation of the same old thing. Wow. Those who are part of a higher economic structure get a better benefit. It's not new, but where are the drugs being placed at? And which children are deemed disruptive because they don't respond to a particular model? I think the whole process was designed to mind or to prospect for certain type of individuals that had value. And those that didn't have value were left to fall beside. So when you say those who fell beside, where did they go? Well, you see more prisons are being built than schools. So when you look at the number of the rate of incarceration to children who have dropped out of school, then you'll see the relationship between the increased prison population or the increased population of incarcerated individuals.
Yes. So the fact that children drop out of school is going back to what I was previously saying, how that if you send children to school that have different ethnicities and different cultures, and the professors and teachers are teaching them things that doesn't reflect on their culture or their ethnicity, they lose interest. For example, history. If you go to history class for 8 years, you would just keep hearing the redundancy of the Anglo's form of government from George Washington being the first president. Oh. Who was the first one of our first presidents?
One of our first presidents.
Listen up, home viewer. This is a fact.
One of our first, our actual first president, while George Washington, whose name I bear, was in the field, can be found on the back of a $2 bill. When you get a chance, go to the bank like I did, retrieve one of these $2 bills, and look at the gentleman to the extreme left. In the rear of that bill. That's John Hanson. He has the same composition as your president, your present president, Mr. Obama. He was half white, half black, half Anglo, half African, any way you would like it, like to say it. You also had your president, Abraham Lincoln, whose mother was Ethiopian. You had Eisenhower, who had mixed blood. We had Thomas Jefferson. We had Cooley. We had Harding. So see, that when some of the naysayers and the troublemakers of our society through the media try to make us believe that America was this totally horrible racist place that would not elect a person of color, you can respond to them with that bill. That was not the case.
And what was his name again?
John Hanson, J-O-N.
And what role did he play in our government in the...
He was the president before this Constitution. Before our present Constitution, he was the president during that Revolutionary War.
How long did he serve?
2 years. 2 years. During those days, they only allowed the presidents to serve 2 years. And they said he did a very, very good job.
But you would never, I've never learned this in history, in history class. And I would think that as a student going to school, that the whole concept of going to school is to be able to affiliate yourself and get information that can actually inspire you and help you develop your thinking thoughts. But if you're going to schools where the schools and don't reflect your ethnicity, your culture, and some of the ideals of your home, it's really hard to sit in those classrooms year after year after year listening to things that have nothing to do with you.
Was, yes. Was Mr. Hansen elected as president, or was he appointed as president?
Now that, don't hold me to it. I don't know. I'll have to do further research.
Because according to history, it says that George Washington was the first elected president.
Mm-hmm.
And then
mm-hmm.
you have to know that there was some form of government before the states ratified the Constitution.
The Constitution,
right.
And it became a country.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And then the whole political process. And I'm...
And there's also some controversy out there about the actual formulation of the Constitution, the authenticity of it, where it came from, who inspired it. And I'm not well acquainted on it, but the information that I have received was that the Constitution came from a collective group of Native American Indians that had this form of government within 11 tribes of the Eastern Seaboard.
Okay.
That a lot of the laws of the Constitution was a part of a tribal collective of 11 tribes here in the eastern coast of America.
There's other theories and other so-called controversial theories that attribute certain other groups, fraternal groups, to have established the Constitution. Nonetheless, it's been established, and for 200 and some years we've been going by it, and I would say thank God for the Constitution, because without the 14th Amendment,
mm-hmm.
I doubt if slavery would have been stopped.
You better believe it.
It's the 14th Amendment and the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendment that gave the descendants of African slaves
mm-hmm.
an opportunity to become citizens of this country and to participate. Now, whether they had full acceptance and full exclusion is another story and another time.
Right.
But I'm in support of the existing Constitution, the existing Bill of Rights, and I don't see any controversy in that.
No, I don't. But my whole premise of speaking about education in depth that we're speaking about it this evening is that I really believe that education is the sole example on how to elevate human beings, on how to be human beings with the pure essence of the absolute truth. When you take the absolute truth out of education, you have a disenfranchised society where people are basically misinformed. And when you have misinformed information out there, you have a society that's always on the verge of a calamity, such as we're going through now in the economical crisis or the political or the so-called terroristic era, where it's all based on lies. And it's based on lies because in the process of education, the absolute is being distorted.
Mm-hmm.
And education should support the absolute 100%. If it starts out with the morality values on how to be a human being, how to lift yourself up, how to dress yourself, how to pull your pants up, mm-hmm. how to tie your shoes, how to sit at a table. The etiquette part of being a human being is just as important as the intellectual, theoretical. Yes, Nate?
Excuse me. Just to interject, I'm in total accord with what you're saying. That's what education is being well-rounded. Also, in us sharing with Berks County this evening the contributions of the African Americans that have been hidden from us all, I'd also like to contribute and say that every ethnic group on this planet that walks with on two legs have contributed to society, our thinking, and our potential to be awesome. All we're saying here this evening is that get to know thyself. wherever we come from. And that in itself elevates each and every one of us.
Yes. Ed?
A particular question?
No. Some of your summaries.
My summary.
Well, let's take this last home viewer, which is really appropriate. Yes, home viewer? Yes, home viewer, your question or?
No, I have a comment. You fellows were talking earlier about what role John Hanson played in the American history.
Mm-hmm. Yes, Dave.
And I looked it up for you quick, and he was born in 1721. Died in 1783, so he didn't live that long, 62 years.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just reading from an old World book. It says he was an early American patriot. He signed the Articles of Confederation. Talks about an early supporter of the American cause. But here's the important part. He was the president of the Continental Congress in 1781. So that gives clarification to the question you had amongst each other earlier. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you, home viewer, for listening. And that's another part of education, the ability to hear. Once you master the ability to hear, then comes understanding.
Mm-hmm.
And you have any other comments or points you were going to mention, Ed, before we go off the air?
No, I'm just sitting here waiting for the results of what's going to take place in the next 5 years with the Reading School District in fact that, you know, there's a lot of money being spent on these children and we're not getting any results.
Mm-hmm.
California spends on average $5,000 per child, and here in the Reading School District there's $10,000 per child being spent. Where's the money coming from and where is it going?
Well, the home viewers who have children in the public school system, I really encourage you to get involved in your school district, get involved in your child's education, mm-hmm. get involved in going out to some of the school board meetings, because I believe this year some of the school board meetings have some issues that are very, very serious and very important for your child's development and your child's learning in the Reading School District. So when there's parent and teachers meetings or there's performances and plays that your children are participating in, please come out to these events and participate, because your child is the future. Your children are the future that carries on your family name, that holds down the family's traditions, and through sending them off to school every day, we are all hoping and praying that they are getting the education that is duly their right. Yes, Nate?
Also, in conclusion, I would like to encourage all of the students and parents and grandparents to constantly read. I have to confess I'm part of the literacy council here. I'm a tutor and I'm thankful to be part of that. Education, I was pulling up some quotes of Helen Keller the other day, and she was saying, do not let college get in the way of your education. She's redundant about that. So education is constantly reading, constantly studying every and anything, and that erects your humanity.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
So we're here every other month with voices from our community, and we'd like to thank everyone in Reading for supporting this program, and we'll be back in one more month or two months for another program, and we'll go into depth with some of the other issues from our community, which we have issues of employment, we have issues of housing. That's a big issue in our community, and there's a lot of chatter about this and that. Where's the money coming from, and where is the redevelopment going, and where is the infrastructure, when is the infrastructure money coming? And the other thing is we're having an election that's coming up in November. I think our next program will be in November. We're having a city government election, which will also inter the county representatives are up for election. And we encourage the home viewers to get involved in the electoral process, get to know the candidates that's out here, get to know who's running for office, get to know who's going to be representing you, and get to know their policies and what their policy stands for, and so that you can support them and hold them accountable for some of the policies that they are trying to change and hold the community to. Thank you very much, and we'd like to say good night.
Good night.